So our today's lesson will now look at a situation where, for example, you invest your money today, it generates you some interest, you don't withdraw that money, but you keep on waiting for more interest to be generated. In other words, the interest is generated on the basis of the principal amount, or rather the amount at the beginning of the time period, plus the reinvested interest to generate more interest. So it's not like in the case of the simple analysis where we had only one time off to determine our interest based on the time period. Here we are generating interest. Let's say if the first year, you add it to your principal amount and it will continuously generate more interest. That is what we call the compound interest method. In our analysis, we shall stick to the elements that we had in our last class. Kindly let's remain on mute. We had the I representing the interest, and of course the interest must be the amount that is between whatever is at the end and what was at the beginning. In other words, interest is computed as the difference between what would be at the end, normally called the accrued amount, minus whatever was at the beginning, normally called the principal amount. P will still stand in for the principal amount, the initial amount, that which you had, for example, put into the account, let's say at the beginning of the time period. A will still stand in for the amount at the end of the time period, whichever now, if you are to make our A here the subject, A must be what was at the beginning of the time period plus whatever the interest has been generated along the way. And now making the I the subject, of course the P will go to this other side. That's why we are saying I must be our accrued amount at the end minus the amount at the beginning, the P, the principal amount. T still represents the time period. Some books they use small letter N, which is okay. And then R denotes the rate of interest. And this can be either taken in decimal or we can have it in percentage. In our compounding, we are going to do it in different ways. And I'm going to start with when you have to wait for a whole year for you to generate interest. What do we call that method? If you are to wait the whole year for us to generate interest, then we talk about class interest generated annually. And in this case, we say when interest, so point number one, when interest is compounded annually. In other words, you only generate interest after a whole 1 year. Another 1 year goes by, you generate more interest. Of course, your principal plus the interest reinvested will generate more interest. And you have to wait another 1 year for you to generate more interest. That form of generating interest, we say, it is under interest compounded annually. In this case, what happens? In this case, we'll determine the amount at the end of the time period. The amount at the end of the time period is going to be given by, you take your principal amount, you multiply by 1 plus the rate. 1 plus the rate, and then my bracket, I'm going to raise it to the power of the time t. I repeat, when interest is generated under the compounded annually, our amount at the end of the time period, I'm not giving the formula for the interest, I'm giving the formula for the amount at the end of the time period, will be take the principal amount into 1 plus the rate, and then you raise it to the power of the time period. Time here taken in full years. If there are 5 years, you indicate your t to be 5. And of course, the rate expressed here must be per annum or rather per year. After you get your amount at the end of the time period, you can now determine the interest. An interest in this case will be given by what? You take your amount at the end of the time period, you minus whatever was at the beginning of the time period. A minus P gives us our interest. And so you have to first of all determine the amount at the end of the time period for you to be able to come up with the interest. Very important for you to note that this formula doesn't generate us the interest. It does generate us what we call the accrued amount, the amount at the end of the time period. And so for you to come up with the interest, you take the amount at the end of the time period, you minus whatever was at the beginning of the time period. Example, Mary invested shillings 30,000 at a rate of 11% per annum for 5 years. Determine, number one, the interest and the accrued amount. And I'll take that. Our method is when interest is compounded annually. When interest is compounded annually, how do we come up with our interest given the scenario about Mary? And again, how do we determine the accrued amount? You see our question here, it's starting with the interest and then the accrued amount. But there's no way to which I can get the interest first without getting the accrued amount. So we'll start with number two. Our amount is given by, we're using the formula, P into 1 plus the rate. Of course, the bracket will raise it to the power of the time period. Our P, our principal amount, is 30,000. Into 1 plus the rate, 11%, we can write it as 0.11. And then the whole of this, we raise it to the power of 5 years. And then we calculate that, which is likely to give us, let's find out. To give us 50,000 551. Of course, with some decimal there, 0.74. I like giving actual figures, especially when we are dealing with amounts. You can imagine this is what is your account reading, and then somebody tells you this is different. Of course, we'll have problems to deal with. So as an accountant, as somebody who is working in the bank, you have to be very careful to make sure you report the actual figures. As much as you can, avoid rounding off, so that we don't accumulate a lot of errors. So this is what our books of account will be reading. When I go back to the bank, I'll demand this amount. Of course, minus some charges that the bank may be charging. This is the actual amount that I should be having at the end of the time period after depositing shillings 30,000, generating interest at a rate of 11% per annum, interest compounded annually, of course, for a period of 5 years. Thus, how much is our interest now? I is the difference between the amount at the end of the time period, which is our A, minus what was at the beginning, the principal amount. And I suppose all of us, with the 50,000 here, minus the principal amount of 30,000, we can be able to tell how much is the interest. I repeat, when interest is compounded annually, we start by the formula on getting the accrued amount. the amount at the end of the time period. And then to find the interest, we take the amount at the end of the time period, we minus whatever was at the beginning of the time period. And that is interest compounded annually. Of course, if the question is about the number of years, if the question is about the rate of interest, if the question is about, let's say, the P, you should be able to make anything the subject from this particular formula. And I hope we can be able to do that. Let's move on to number two now. Number two is when we have interest is compounded semi-annually. When we compound interest semi-annually, what happens? A year has got 6 months, two periods of that. Two periods of six months will make a whole year. Meaning, you are generating interest twice in a year. Let's say from January up to June, you generate some interest. Your principal plus that interest generated, you reinvest it to generate more interest in the next half of the year, say from July through December. Another maybe year, the first half, you generate more interest. That is the one we call interest compounded semi-annually, or rather half yearly, or you can also say after every six months. You generate interest after every 6 months. In this method, we'll determine also our amount at the end of the time period, which is supposed to be given by the principal amount into 1 plus. The rate given is per annum. What do I do with that rate? I need to divide it by 2. And then the number of years given are full years, but every year has two periods of six months. So we multiply the number of years by 2. I repeat, the rate of interest generating interest is actually given per annum, in other words, for a whole year. But for you to get a comfortable rate for a half an year, you need to divide that particular interest by 2. The interest rate by 2, sorry. And then the number of years which are full years, of course you want to know how many half years do we have in a given number of years. You multiply each year by 2 periods of six months. And then if you want now to determine the interest, thus our interest, of course, again, is a difference between the amount at the end of the time period minus what was at the beginning of the time period. You first of all get the amount at the end of the time period, and then you minus whatever was at the beginning for you to arrive at the interest. An example, let's go back to our previous illustration here, where interest now is going to be generated, the interest to be generated half yearly. In other words, after every 6 months. How do we determine the interest in this case? Get the interest, we first of all determine the amount at the end of the time period. So we'll first of all get what is A, and then we can now determine our I. Our amount at the end of the time period will be given by class. The principal is 30,000. Our rate of interest, which is 11%, the same as 0.11, we first of all determine this as per half a year, we divide by 2. And then the number of years given are 5. For each, we have 2 periods of half a year. We'll multiply each year by 2 to arrive at how many periods of 6 months in total are there in 5 years. And then we can do our workings to arrive at the amount at the end of the time period. And this will give us what? Let's find out. Gives us 51,244. Point, we have said it's important to maintain accuracy as much as you can. To those who have some banks accounts, you agree with me that the bank's accounts do come with funny figures, and that is what we want to maintain for the purposes of accountability in the bank. Even when you're paying for a loan that you have borrowed, you want to pay the actual amount, not an approximated figure. Okay, so that is our amount at the end of the time period. Thus, to come up with our interest, what do we do? Interest will now be given by, take whatever is the amount at the end of the time period, and of course you minus the principal amount, which I hope all of us, we can comfortably determine that. I repeat, if interest in the scenario about Mary, who invested shillings 30,000 at a rate of 11% per annum for 5 years, if this interest is compounded semi-annually means after every half an year, you're generating some interest, then our amount will be given by, the formula is, the principal into 1 plus the rate you divide by 2 first, and then the number of years, make sure you multiply each year by 2 periods, of course, of 6 months. That is our number 2. And we have said to get the interest, you get the amount at the end of the time period, you minus whatever was at the beginning of the time period. Okay. Point number 3. We have a scenario where when interest now is compounded quarterly. If I were to ask you how many quarters are there in a year, I expect that you'd say an year has 4 quarters. And then an year has 4 quarters, of which each quarter comes after every 3 months. And many companies do operate in that scenario. The first quarter, they register their performance. Another quarter, they register their performance. So in a whole year, we'll have registered our performance 4 times. So how do we determine a scenario where I go to the bank, for example, I invest my money or any other investment fund, and then the interest is to be generated quarterly after every 3 months. If you can write there, after every months. How do we come up with the amount at the end of the time period? In this case, class, amount is given by accrued amount at the end of the time period, okay? Principal amount into, for your interest, you want that which is comfortable for a quarter. And because an year has 4 quarters, then that rate per annum divide by 4 to get that which is per a quarter, and then you raise your bracket on the number of quarters, which will be given by each year, multiplied by the four quarters in each year to get the total number of quarters in your period of time. I repeat, the amount at the end of the time period, if interest is compounded quarterly, should be given by the following: the principal amount into 1 plus the rate. Since this rate is for a whole year, you're supposed to divide it by 4 to get a comfortable rate per a quarter. And then the number of years, you take the whole years, then each year has 4 quarters, so you're multiplying T by 4 quarters to arrive at the number of quarters in a whole period, given, of course, there could be number of years mentioned, okay? Now, after you arrive at the amount at the end of the time period, it's when you can now be able to determine the interest, which is supposed to be given by, again, the difference between that which is at the end and what was at the beginning of the time period. I repeat, the amount at the end of the time period minus that which is at the beginning, of course, that difference gives us our interest amount. An example. Let's refer to the Mary scenario. Mary this time has walked into an investment fund, and that the interest this time is going to be generated quarterly under the compounding method. I repeat, the scenario about Mary here is that Mary, with the same condition, she will invest 30,000. The rate of interest still stands at 11% per annum for 5 years. But the interest will be compounded after every 3 months, in other words, quarterly. How much will be the amount at the end of the time period? We can do that calculation. Our amount at the end of the time period, applying the formula, will be given by, we take 30,000. One plus, what do we do to the rate of interest? Which is 11% per annum, the same as 0.11. You're supposed to divide it by 4 first. And then we raise this to the power of, we have 5 years, each year has 4 quarters. So we multiply by 4 quarters in each year. Let's find out how much will be this amount when interest is going to be compounded quarterly. That gives us 51,612. We maintain accuracy as much as we can. 0.85294. This would be the amount at the end of the time period. And now, with the amount known at the end, you can be able now to determine your interest. We should be the accrued amount. You minus whatever is the amount at the beginning of the time period. And I'm hoping that all of us, we can be able to determine that interest. You'd take the 51,000 here, you minus the 30,000 to arrive at the difference, which we can call the interest. We repeat. Sometimes we want to invest on an investment fund that is generating interest, let's say, after every 3 months. We call such form of interest as interest compounded quarterly. And in this case, we first of all determine the amount at the end of the time period, which is going to be given by the principal amount into 1 plus the rate. We divide by 4 for the number of years we have said. Since each year we have 4 quarters, we multiply the years by 4 to arrive at the number of quarters. And then the difference between that which is at the end and that which is at the beginning is called our interest. Finally, let's move to our scenario number four, which is a common situation, especially when somebody borrows some money. Maybe you are required to be servicing your loan every other month. We call it interest. Compounded on 3. Every 1 month, you generate interest, or if you're making any payments, of course, there's an amount to be required to pay after every 1 month. In this case, how do we arrive at the amount at the end of the time period? The amount at the end of the time period is given by the formula, the principal amount into 1 plus the rate given. For example, in the scenario about Mary here, is per annum for a whole year. You express that rate to be comfortable for a period that we call 1 month. So you take the rate of interest given. A year has 12 months, so we are going to divide our rate per year by 12 months to arrive at a comfortable rate that can be applicable per a month. That's why sometimes when you borrow money, for example, you'll be told the interest is expressed on the basis of, if it is 12% per annum, then you may be told 1% per month. Yeah, that is, you have taken the 12%, which is per a whole year, and you have divided that by the 12 months in total, making 1 year. And then your number of years were T years, each year having 12 months. So you need to multiply this figure by 12 months to arrive at the total number of months. For example, when you invest, you may be told the investment is going to last for, let's say, 5 years. How many months are those? You'll be told 60 months. If, let's say, you have borrowed, then you'll be told you'll be servicing this particular loan, for example, over a number of months mentioned, not the years, because you'll be, for example, paying your regular amounts, for example, will be coming every other month to service that particular loan. So in the expression of how interest is being generated, we say this is when interest is compounded monthly. You have found the amount at the end of the time period. And now to arrive at the interest, which could be a concern, you take the amount at the end of the time period and you minus the principal amount. The amount at the end of the time period minus the principal amount. Let's use our example here about Mary, and this time we take that interest is being compounded monthly. With the same conditions still standing, that is, the principal amount still at 30,000, the interest rate is still at 11% per annum. So this is for a whole year. We want to divide it by 12 to get a comfortable rate per a month. And of course, the number of years still remains as 5 years. So how much is the amount at the end of the time period? This will be given by the principal amount, which is 30,000, into 1 plus the rate, which is 11% per annum. We can divide that one by 12. So we take it in decimal first, 0.11 we divide by 12, and then we raise this to the number of months. For 5 years, each having 12 months. We multiply here by 12. And let's see how much will that be. Gives us an amount of 61,867.4971. Of course, in shillings, depending on the number of units indicated applicable in your analysis. Ours was in shillings. So that is the amount at the end of the time period. And from here, we can be able to tell how much will be the interest which you have agreed. You take whatever is at the end of the time period, and of course, you minus the principal amount, which I suppose we can be able to do that. We have 30,000 as our P. The amount is at 51,000. You get the difference. That difference is your interest. So that is how we may generate interest, other than the interest, the simple interest method, which we had said it's generated only once, yeah, over a given number of years. This one we are generating as many times as possible, of course, depending on the forms of compounding applicable where the investment is taking place. If it is annually, we have a formula to use. If it is, semi-annually, we have said twice in a year. Again, we have a formula to apply. If it is after every 3 months, meaning quarterly, we will have generated interest 4 times in a year. And again, we have the formula to apply. And if it is monthly, for 12 times each month, there's some interest that is being generated. Again, you can be able to determine that. And I'm hoping that with our lesson for today, if tomorrow now, interest, yes, is compounded, let's say semi-annually, but the question is about the T. The question is about maybe the P. The question could be about the R. We should be able to make it the subject in the question, of course, to be able to address the problem depending on what is being asked. Again, if it is on the compounding monthly, and the question is about any one of these items that we have identified here, either the P, the A, the R, the I, the T, all these, we should be able to make them the subject in our main formula, and so we should be able to address the question, or rather, give the right solution to the problem. So that is our lesson for today. Before maybe we terminate, any questions?